Hello and welcome to another video on Rust. In this one, we are going to try and change this photo into something that looks a little bit more like this photo. We're trying to learn how to pixelate an image. This is, you know, I was always curious about how this happened as a child, and I thought I would sort of figure it out. And so I've got a bit of an implementation, and I'd like to share it with you. These three birds are actually from Bangladesh. They are in English known as chestnut-tailed starlings. The link to this photo is in the description below. Okay, so let's start with some code. I've got a small little program here, and you can see some debugging output from my sort of test run. Hello, internet. Nice to see you. And that's not extremely interesting, but we'll get there. So one of the things that we're going to use is this as an image library, and the URL is also in the description. Go to docs.rs and you can actually go just straight to /image and you will get to the right place. And this enables us to import a third-party library called image. And its API is kind of useful, and it provides us with an image reader class. Or not actually, not a class, it's just an image reader data type that provides provides this API, which I've highlighted for you. We create a reader from a file with an open method, and then we sort of decode it, which inspects the actual inspects the path and says, well, this is probably a PNG image, so I'll use PNG decoding. If you just have some random bytes, you can also just ask ImageReader to actually go and inspect the bits and bytes inside your buffer, and it will do the decoding itself. But we don't need to worry about that so much. We'll create an image from image, and then it's in IO, and we need this reader thing. You'll notice that, well, you may have recalled that in the documentation, it comes out as image reader. So there's this renaming process, and that's, I assume, to avoid conflicting with standard IO read, which is a trait that's extremely common and probably quite easy to confuse. So we'll just use that same pattern as well. My original image is called starlings.jpg. And if I recall, there was also a question mark. And I'll just reduce the size just very slightly. Now, it turns out we immediately hit our first compiler warning. There's it says that the question mark operator can only be used in a function that returns a result or an option. And we don't return a result. So it's just kind of naively return a result. And the type that we'll provide that return is, we're just gonna go with unit. And what is a unit? It's sort of the equivalent of Rust's nothing type. It means it's sort of, it's empty. It represents its own value, which is essentially a placeholder for nothing. Now, this isn't quite the right result. Requires T and E. T is fine. We can return unit as the T version of the result, but not for the error variant. And but Rust actually provides us some interesting diagnostics as to what we actually require. What it's saying is that the question mark can't convert an error to unit, and that's because the question mark operator has two roles. Its first role is to propagate any errors up from, in this case, the open method into main. So if an error is generated during open, it will then be sort of, it will bubble up to main and immediately return straight away. But its error type isn't a unit. It's actually Something else, and it's the standard I/O error, which is very close to standard I/O read, and that's slightly important because if we return this, if we say that actually our function returns the same thing, our main method suddenly works. So we can actually read our file in from the from disk, and we could actually get the dimensions. Let's just say, just to confirm that we are actually reading it in, and I'm not cheating on you. I think it's, oh, actually, this isn't quite enough, but we will see, because I haven't decoded it. So I've got a reader there, it's ready to read, but actually it isn't quite ready for me to go and inspect it. However, I'll just see if we can get through this error message. And it compiles again. We print out hello internet, which is somewhat useful, I suppose. we've now taken the time to collect something in RAM but what we actually want is a real image. Now, so we need to go through this decoding step, and then we use our question mark again. Unfortunately, we immediately run into another problem, and that is that, let's see if, and that is the decode method of a reader, it returns a different error type than the open method. The open method relates to files, and so it provides a standard I/O error, but this decoding step, it relates much more to talking about what an image is. And it turns out that it is saying that we've got an image error type, which is defined within, in this case, it's actually from PNG. Like, we've got a bunch of things for being able to convert between one or two other file formats. But standard I/O error doesn't sort of convert naturally into that. So I'm just going to bring this into the scope of the program, and say, and so we kind of want a type that could be either an image error or an I/O error. Now, a good way to start out if you're just using a main function is actually to create is this syntax here, where we have a box, which essentially is a pointer to a dynamic, which is an standard error. Now, this is known as a trait object. A trait object is defined at runtime, and so the reason why we require a pointer to some dynamic error is that it will be determined because the compiler doesn't know at compile time exactly how much size to allocate in for local variables, and essentially this just kind of provides us a way out. The reason why it works, if I push save now, the errors go away. The reason why it works is that these concrete error types know how to turn themselves into trait objects, and so the conversion step works. And now I should be able to print out the dimensions from my image. it turns out that I actually want to bring in something else from into local scope. I need another method. So one of the things that Rust does is it requires the traits to be in locally, and it's one of the interesting things about this is we've got a tuple here of and how about I say x and y, or actually this should probably be width height, and I can now print out width and height. The cool thing, or did I say, what I'm going to try to do with my terminology in this tutorial is to use the terms width and height to mean the full dimensions, and the the variable names X and Y to mean a specific coordinate with inside the particular image. So this will make sense in a moment when we start actually interacting with our file, like in with inside our images. Ugh, that didn't make any sense. We're going to start manipulating pixels, and that's going to mean we're going to need to distinguish between the height and width of the image that we're dealing with from the coordinates of an individual pixel. Okay. So let's create our high level plan. I want a function pixelate that pixeledge that takes as an argument a reference to some image, and that will be a dynamic image. And the reason why I'm picking dynamic image is because that's what image reader returns. And I am now going to return an image buffer, and the image buffer type is actually itself parameterized by a internal file format, which is RGBA, and then we're going to use U8s inside it. If this syntax looks extremely clunky, if you're not familiar with it, so I am just going to create a type image, a bit of a type alias, or we could even call this like pixel array or pixel matrix, because at this point the this image buffer thing is a decompressed image, and it describes the way that each byte or what it is representing. But I think we'll just keep it at image. It's going to be slightly confusing because we're now using image in about four different places, but I hope that you will bear with me. We're going to operate this by calling, actually I'll just head to add a to do, and I'll show you. So we've got let image, and I'm going to just use a trailing underscore to mean that I am sort of essentially modifying the original. We've got a pixelate, and it's going to return some other image, and then I'm going to call image underscore save, and then I'm going to call it pixelated dot png, and the dot png is somewhat isn't essential, but you'll find that the png output will look a lot nicer than the jpeg output, or but those are not exclusive options. You can play around with others if you would prefer. Okay, so now we implement pixelated. So to undertake our pixelation, we are going to shrink our original image and then blow it up again to the original size, but essentially expanding the small version. That will kind of act as a compression step. So to start, I'll create all dimensions and image dimensions, and then the other thing that I need is some new dimensions, which is another U32 and a U32. And for pixelate here, I'm just going to say that we provide, we'll just try 10 by 10. And so we've got old and new, and then I'm going to create like a small version, and that will be some call to a resize function that we'll just implement. And the resize will take an image as an argument. And by the way, we don't actually need to do this from scratch. I think we could probably just call, a resize function. It looks like there was one available within the image crate itself, but let's implement it from scratch because it's kind of more fun. And that will take an image as well as the new dimensions. And so to get there, I will divide the old dimensions by the new ones. This will allow me to kind of play quite easily together. We don't necessarily need to do the division, but it can, it will mean that the aspect ratio is the same. It just means that it's proportional. And oh, I didn't do that right. So 0, 0, all dimensions 1 divided by new dimensions 1. I think, and they're saying, where is this resize function? Resize doesn't exist yet. And image. Is going to be a reference to an image with a capital I, and it return that same return the same buffer, and we'll just add to do there for the moment. And we have, oh, it also requires this extra argument to the intended dimensions, and we have a pixelated version, which essentially is exactly the same as resize. Sorry, is this creation of small on line 13, except that we take small as the input argument, and our new dimensions are actually the original dimensions, which is why we stored old dims in a local variable. Okay, that was the wrong button. So okay, the code is looking a little bit messy, but I hope that will be fine. The last thing to do here is return pixelated. Strictly, we don't need an extra variable name here, but it can be it kind of is useful for some people to kind of well, I suppose it will improve the ability for you to kind of read what's actually happening. Okay, so now we've got the actual work to do. We've got our strategy in place. Okay, so this is a problem. We have the wrong type. And what we're going to do is convert our our dynamic image into a concrete image type. So this 2RGBA8 is this thing. We can actually, so that is the type of image format internally in memory. And now resize is happy over here. Okay, so now we can compile it. I could cargo build, and the type error, sorry, the type system will be relatively happy. If we try and run this, it will immediately crash because the to-do macro will just say this hasn't been implemented yet. But it's a way for us to get through the problem. Okay, so now it becomes really important to distinguish between X, Y, height, and width. Because if we get them confused, all of the mathematics will get very confusing very quickly. If you try to implement these things by hand yourself, and the errors become really difficult to comprehend, there are some debugging tricks that I'll add actually at the end of the video if I don't need them myself. So it's possible that I will actually end up requiring some debugging, because I'm about to do something which is particularly about to do something that's like particularly irritating. And because if you create an image buffer and we're going to start manipulating individual pixels, and we do it the wrong way around. So for example, I just provided new height and I should have provided a width. So I will fix that. You get these the wrong way around, and it almost works until it looks terrible. And then we're at the end of our function, we are going to return this resize thing. And in the middle here is our work. Now, one of the things to do would be to create a, we're going to do is map every pixel in our resized image buffer and map that to its the closest neighbor, or sorry, the closest corresponding pixel in the original, if that makes any sense. And it turns out that we can just start with zero and go to, we could do this, we could say for x in 0 to dot dot, and then we would probably want new width and go through all the way. And in fact, we would need to do inclusive or, and then we could go through y, it turns out, and then we pull out the individual pixel, but we won't actually need to do that. We have gotten the image crate provides a really handy iterator, and it is coming up, so you know, which is called enumerate pixels, and we want mute for mutation. And this provides x, y coordinates as well as the pixel. And it's actually, you can see here, a mutable reference to some to some pixel. Now that things get really irritating, or at least really complicated really quickly, because if we get the maths here wrong, it becomes extremely, I say this, you may be noticing, as someone who's actually tried to actually do this a few times and I've gotten really stuck. So we need to find the proportion of like how the percentage are vertical or horizontal that the pixels are on their respective images. So we want to find, so we get new x, and we sort of say divide it by the multiply it by the proportion of say old width. Have I been using weight? Let's rename. I'm just talking about how important it is to be very specific, and the other thing that I've called it the wrong word. So, and then we divide it by a new width. So this will find how far through it is, with some caveats, and I will explain those fairly soon. So old height. I always think of y as the vertical axis, because it has longer downslope. That's my way. That's my kind of way through. And then we want to actually update this pixel. And to do so, I can say pixel, and then in the original image, I've got this get pixel method that takes an x and a y, and that's an old x and old y. And that returns a reference to the pixel inside the buffer. You can see that we've got an ampersand p. But what we actually need to do is update pixel to be the, oh gosh, cannot mutate a variable. I'm gonna do something different. I'm gonna take that reference away. And then add the dereference operator here, so that everything works relatively happily. Now, let's give this a go. We've actually implemented the bulk of what we wanted to do. So ideally, if at the end of this process, there will be remove that warning. Why is that unhappy? Mismatch types. Oh, okay. There will be a pixelated.png file created from this process. So if I cargo run, probably a whole bunch of warnings, but it works until it panics. It's like, well, uh-oh. Now, it's possible, probably likely, that I have actually introduced a bug as I've been going through. You know, you saw me writing weight instead of width. Now, but the problem is that we've got these kind of out-of-bounds errors, which is extremely irritating. Now, one way to get around this, and it's not necessarily the best way, but it's a way. Oh, actually, I'll show you one of the things that we can do while we're debugging. And one of the important characteristics is to remember that I've got these temporary variables. I've got small here and then pixelated. And one we know, and they actually have save methods. And I could say debug small.png, and it, I'm going to unwrap to say that it will always succeed. And then down here, I can say pixelated.save debug pixelated unwrap. Now, so if I go to my file directory, these are the original images. What we're going to hopefully see is at least one extra image. Okay, so we got our problem. Oh, we didn't get anything. Okay, so that means that the problem was caused inside this original resize. So we actually don't have anything to go on. It turns out that the problem is likely to be in this conversion step here, because notice we are using U32 integers to do mathematics, and that is a potential problem because we have rounding errors all over the place. That means we might actually access things that we don't want to. And now the problem is that this is extremely messy. And once we have finished it up, we then convert it back to U32. So we convert all of our variables into floating point numbers and then do the mathematics and then cast it back into an unsigned integer. Let's see if that helps. We get another panic. Uh-oh. But let's see if we have any images available. Pixie. No, there's nothing. Okay, so now I have to quickly hunt. The one issue we've got is that it's this old X and Y, old Y, is a little bit weird. Okay. So now we try something else. We call get pixel checked, and get pixel checked will return an option. If we have an actual pixel, and saying that it can't be dereferenced. Okay, that's fine. That's not a problem. So we go and get the pixel out of the original, and now it's in here in some sense, at least a reference to it. And now we want to go and update the pixel at resize. So this, we're using the same variable in two places. So that's a problem. So this is original. Now we need to update pixel and with old pixel, I think. Now, hopefully, we no longer crash, and there should be some images in here. And you can see that we're actually getting fairly close. We've got a square. which is a hint on the issue that is actually being created. But we have some space down here. It's a checkerboard sort of pattern. And now if we go back to debug pixelated, this is the bigger one. You can see that the aspect ratio is kind of all weird, and we've got another part that's out of bounds here on the right. And so our translation between one image and the other has gone wrong. So let's continue to kind of debug this. And where have I gone wrong? It's often the case that you will start X, Y, old width, new width. So one of the things we can also do is like ask where it is that, so if the else on this side is like, well, if we couldn't find old X, then we should print it out. And I'm going to print out, we'll just print, and I'll say we're moving from old X and we're going to new X. And these are the pixels that we can't find, and we've got old Y and we want to translate to new Y. And now over here on the right, I can run it again, and cargo provides, will send all arguments that are to the right of two dashes. It will send that to the executable itself. And so we are going to use shell direction to print out an error log. Okay, so now with inside our files, there should be an error log. And we'll see here that we have specific pixels which are not able to be translated. I just want to double check that I've got all of this correct. Image, new dimensions, new dimensions. Oh. So the convention is that width always is on the left. It goes XY, not YX. And I wonder if this debug pixelated. Hooray! We have it in the, we've got it correct. This is a significant improvement from what we had before. And our pixelated PNG actually looks perfect. So well done to us for debugging that. Congratulations if you knew that was the problem right at the start. It's always frustrating to watch someone scream while you're sort of screaming at the screen. Now let's just to check what happens as we change the new dimensions. So this is actually an inaccurate variable name. It's not actually the intended dimensions of our of the output size. It's kind of more it relates to the size of the pixels. And let's run our program again. We don't actually need error log because there are no errors, but oh well. And now our pixels are getting smaller. So that's fun. So they, it'd be interesting to see whether or not they are actually 5 pixels wide. Probably not. Let's say we wanted something really blocky. There we go. We've got something very blocky. I hope this has been a lot of fun, and I encourage you to play around with the code. We will see you on the next video. If you've made it this far, I sincerely encourage you to subscribe to the channel. There are videos like this coming through all the time, and I am very optimistic that you are going to have a really fun time learning Rust. Okay, bye-bye.